First, I guess I'll give apologies for both Nick Enfield and Colin White. Nick sort of runs the show on the Post-Truth Initiative, and Colin usually chairs these sessions. Neither one of them could be here, so I get to do it all by myself. Before we get going, because I'll change the slide fairly soon, I just wanted to explain this picture. This is from suburban New York, near where I grew up. And that is kids running through basically a DDT fog in the 1960s, which I used to do all the time. So I'll explain the relevance of that in a bit. But before I get going, I guess I should introduce myself, and then I actually want to hear who's here. So my name is David Schlossberg. I'm a professor of environmental politics in government and international relations, and I'm also the co-director of the Sydney Environment Institute. And I'm one of the researchers, along with many others around the table, in this Post-Truth Initiative. I should say, most of what I'm going to talk about is not really stuff I usually do. Right? Most of my work is in environmental justice, environmental movements, sustainability, adaptation planning, resilience stuff now, more food politics. So this sort of the post-truth stuff is a fairly new thing for me, and the methodology even more so. We'll explain that, but I'll talk a little bit more about that. But I did want to get a sense of who you all are, because this is a different crowd for me. So why don't we go around, starting with Hannah.
Yes. Hi,
my
name is Hannah Belawoska, and I am a research assistant on the Post-Truth Initiative project, and also at the Sydney Environment.
Hello, my name's Mitchell Hobbs. I'm a lecturer in media and communications, and I write a lot about media and politics and lobbying and that type of thing.
Hi, I'm Natasha Lee. I'm a retired person. I worked most of my life in government, particularly the Environment Protection Authority from 2000 to 2004, and most of my career was New South Wales Treasury as a financial analyst economist, and that's why I'm interested in this topic.
Christine
Winter,
I'm one of David's PhD students.
I've scared the rest of them away.
Only because they graduate. Nothing else is happening.
I thought it sounded much better the other way.
You're right.
Sorry.
I'm Maria Cusone. I'm a postdoctoral fellow in the linguistics department.
Hi, I'm Dean Jones. I'm a part-time art student here, but what I really do is write columns and blogs, mostly about political corruption and associated issues.
Hi, I'm John Rothman. I'm a data scientist and research engineer with the Sydney Informatics Hub, and I'm trying to attack bullshit computation, it seems.
I'm Charles Stone. I'm a data scientist in SAS, and I get involved with Mitchell and David and Hannah for scraping some Twitter data for this work later.
We're just observers. Some of my relations to the faculty, we're actually working on a bunch of different stuff that includes Alana and David, so we're just here listening.
Just trying to see how I actually speak in public.
It's not too late to pull it.
Generally interesting.
I'm Joy Murray. I work with Manfred Lenson in the Integrated Sustainability Analysis Group in the School of Physics, and I'm part of this post-truth.
Hi, I'm Malifa Vandali. I'm a PhD student in the Department of Gender and Cultural Studies.
Hello, I'm Yvonne Mayer. I'm a concerned citizen about the environment and the lack of the power of the environment voice against economics.
Fantastic, and I'm with what she said, basically.
That's exactly
how I feel too. I'm the chair of media and communications here at the University of Sydney, and I'm part of a research node that David directs at the as part of his work at the Sydney Environment Institute, and it's called Food, People and the Planet. And so I work on food sovereignty issues. I talk to farmers a lot. I've just written something for The Conversation for this as part of this initiative about growing food in the post-truth era. So I'm very interested in that, about the way corporations are capturing the climate change rhetoric and what that means in terms of post-truth discourse.
So I have lots of help around the table, is another way of putting that. So I get started. There are really three parts to this talk. First, and there will be language. So first, a bit of a history of environmental bullshit more generally. Second, is a discussion about the relationship between lies, bullshit, and ideology, which is really where I'm coming at this question from. And third, just a little bit about the project that we are trying to do, which is not so much about bullshit detection as it is about finding the bull, if that makes any sense. We'll come back to that. But to lower expectations here, I just want to clarify, there won't be any findings reported. The point of today really is just to lay out some of the background and the rationale for this project and then give you a bit of methodology. So it's pretty preliminary in the thinking. We hope to have something to show you by now, but we've been hung up by ethics, so we can't actually do the Twitter scraping that we wanted to do. Right? And I just don't understand how the President of the United States can endanger the planet with his tweets, but we can't call out tweeters to shame them in any way for misleading the public. So, at least not yet. So, again, I grew up outside of New York City in the suburbs on Long Island and have vivid memories, both visual and it's the smell. I was talking to my wife last night about the smell that came out of these trucks. Running behind the DDT truck spraying for mosquitoes, we would run and hide in the fog. So this happened right up until DDT was banned for this kind of spraying in 1972. So I hadn't really thought about this until recently, but my experience of running through the fog trucks, running through the fog, behind the fog trucks, was due to environmental bullshit. Right? it was only because of the industry tactics of what we would now call post-truth that those trucks were allowed to go through that neighborhood spraying that stuff after I was born, after Rachel Carson's Silent Spring. So Rachel Carson published Silent Spring in 1962, before I was born. It addressed the dangers of DDT, right? The whole idea of Silent Spring is DDT kills off the songbird species. Carson herself tried to expose the disinformation that was being spread by the chemical industry, and she was, of course, soundly and untruthfully attacked for her own views, for being a communist, for being an opponent of progress. Silent Spring, the book, so the publishers were really freaked out about this, right? It wasn't just something that was put out there. Silent Spring was thoroughly vetted. It wasn't anything new. What Carson did was to popularize some of the science that had already been done. There's a lot of folks doing the same sort of thing around climate science now. It was well vetted, and then it was incredibly popular. But after it was released, sort of lies of the industry, the bullshit that continued for about a decade, kept DDT from being banned for that kind of usage until 1972. And the thing that concerns me about Carson, or one of the things that's, I guess it shouldn't be surprising, but the lies just don't go away. So there was a revival of the vilification of Carson in around 2009. One of the same think tanks that is responsible for a lot of the climate denialism, the Competitive Enterprise Institute, began reiterating one of the main claims against Carson, which was refuted in the 60s, that she is responsible, and you'll hear this on any of the right-wing sites, that Rachel Carson is responsible for the deaths of millions of people due to malaria, right? Because DDT was outlawed, and so we can't spray DDT to treat mosquitoes that cause malaria. So the reality, of course, is that DDT was banned for agriculture and for spraying on kids in suburban neighborhoods, but it was never banned for anti-malarial use. Even now, you can use DDT for anti-malarial use. But the right and the dirtiest chemical industry players in all of industrial capitalism just like to paint environmentalists as killers, killers of people, of progress, of jobs, and all of that. And that's not just bullshit. That's very carefully manufactured lies and disinformation. That's an early example of post-truth. And so we have, especially in the US but elsewhere, a very large number of people who believe Rachel Carson is not a beautiful writer about the environment, but instead a flat-out mass murderer. So that sort of reflecting on the DDT and on Carson and on Carson as the victim of this sort of post-truth, environmental post-truth, got me thinking about a bit more of the history. And this is not new. So.
Just push on it.
No, it isn't.
It's not like I speak that loudly, being disruptive. So this this anti-environmentalist rhetoric, this tactic of countering critiques of industrial impacts on the planet with sort of lies and obfuscation and defamation has a long history. And in the environmental movement, at least in the environmental movement of the 20th century, it goes back to some of the earliest urban environmentalism, some of the work on municipal housekeeping in the US. So it's a sort of late 19th century, early 20th century progressive era. The urban environmental movement really began with women. It began in the late 1880s with the Ladies Health Protective Association in New York. The City Beautiful movement, that moved on to some other work, wearing white wings, city cleaners, you know, the guys that would go around shoveling. Sweeping horseshit off the streets of New York City in their lovely white suits. But municipal housekeeping was mainly a women's movement to clean up cities. It eventually led, and environmentalists and urban environmentalists give credit to the municipal housekeeping movement for really getting governments to pick up both on public health, so public health departments coming out of the municipal housekeeping movement, and a lot of public planning and zoning as well. So the movement was really a brilliant use of the traditional role of women to put pressure on cities to clean up, in particular a range of types of waste, municipal waste, abattoir waste, to actual horseshit on the streets, which was a constant problem as it would dry up and the dust would fly into people's homes. The opposition, of course, so meat packers, fertilizer makers, the waste industry labeled these women bad housekeepers. The only reason they wanted to mother and keep the community clean is because they were so bad at such things at home. All of this kind of, you know, hysteria and bad women. Municipal housekeeping was only a movement against domestic housekeeping. They weren't real women. They were only concerned with themselves. All this kind of stuff was propagated by the polluting industries. And again, it was just another example of the kind of post-truth and bullshit and attacks on environmentalists that have come from industry. So, it shouldn't be surprising that both that early generation and then the Carson, those sorts of attacks and the lies and the obfuscation, all of that was quite gendered. Right? So post-truth at both of those points is quite gendered. So this, again, this isn't new stuff. One of the things that got me into environmental politics is when I was living in the Pacific Northwest, and the timber wars of the 1980s was a big theme while I was getting my PhD. So again, another example of where environmentalists were scapegoated for the loss of timber jobs. And the story is very similar to what we're dealing with here. Right? Those jobs were, in truth, declining due to automation in the industry, and the shifting of a lot of the resources outside of the Pacific Northwest. But the controversy over the spotted owl, which was an endangered, which was declared endangered, and so there were some issues with The main issue with the owl was, once it was endangered, the question is how much forest does an owl need? How much forest does a pair of nesting owls need to propagate the next generation? And the environmental science was fairly clear about the range that each pair of nesting owls would need. And if you ran that science and you talked about what it would take to have a viable population into the future, there was a large piece of land that needed to be protected for each of those owls, and a larger piece for all owls together. But of course, the industry attacked all of that. The narrative was that environmentalists cared more about birds than jobs. They wouldn't be happy until the economy was devastated. All the changes in the industry that harm workers were due to these environmental regulations, nothing to do with the industry itself. And then the attack on science was ramped up as well. So after this idea of the size of the range that was necessary, the industry captured Forest Service in the US just sort of came up with new numbers and said, no, each pair of nesting owls only needs this much, and then they developed a whole logging plan based on bullshit science. That was based, it was fantasy, it was wishful thinking, it was based in the lies of the industry. So the timber wars of the Pacific Northwest then are another example of environmental science on the one hand, countered by industry lies supported by government on the other. So all this is just to say none of this is new. So of course, all of this culminates in the climate change denial machine that has been growing since the 1980s. A set of lies developed by the fossil fuel industry through a range of conservative think tanks, funded by the industry, laundered through a range of conservative foundations, spun and repeated by right-wing media outlets, adopted as ideology by the Republican Party in the US, with representatives that are supported by the industry and by conservative funding of elections. So what this bit is, this is a bit from Riley Dunlop and Aaron McWright, who wrote a piece on the climate denial machine for the Oxford Handbook of Climate Change and Society that I co-edited a few years ago. It's really nice to get attention when you do something like that, but it's kind of frustrating when you edit an 800-page book and the one thing that gets attention across the press all over the place is just one figure of that 800 pages. So this got a lot of play in the US press, this description of the climate denial machine in the US, because it's about as thorough as it gets. So there's the industry and the foundations, the think tanks, the front groups, the echo chamber, and then the AstroTurf organizations that repeat all of the stuff. So the goal of this machine, as Dunlop and McWright have written, well, it's basically, it's a well-funded, highly, this is a quote from them, well-funded, highly complex, relatively coordinated denial machine of contrarian scientists, fossil fuel corporations, conservative think tanks, front groups, amateur climate bloggers, public relations firms, AstroTurf groups, which we'll come back to, conservative media pundits and conservative politicians. And the goal is clear, right? No regulation on industry, no climate policy whatsoever, what Bob Roulet calls the institutionalization of delay. And the tools are fairly straightforward, the lies, obfuscation, defamation, and creation of uncertainty. So the merchants of doubt idea that Ruskis has written about. So the current state of affairs, of course, is that after 30 years of this climate denial machine in the US, we have at least 180 members of Congress and senators who are declared climate deniers. They've received over $82 million in campaign contributions from the fossil fuel industry and conservative think tanks and their partners. So it's a long story, it's a complicated story, it's a well-tread story. Michael Mann, who was here a few months ago, has written extensively about it. Naomi Oreskes, as I said. Now, one of the frustrating things is that this has been going on a very long time. This has been going on since at least the 1980s. And the history is important. So just a few days ago, there was the story in the New York Times, a major front page story in the New York Times, how GOP leaders came to view climate change as fake science. Now, one of the opening sentences of this story is jaw-dropping to me. So, quote, "The Republican Party's fast journey from debating how to combat human-caused climate change to arguing that it does not exist is a story of big political money, Democratic hubris in the Obama years, and a partisan chasm that grew over 9 years like a crack in the Antarctic shelf, favoring extreme positions and uncompromising rhetoric over cooperation and conciliation. So that's the general explanation from the New York Times about the climate denial machine. Environmental sociologist Robert Poulet, who's written on this stuff for 30 years, took to Twitter to trash this piece, primarily the short time frame. Climate obfuscation doesn't start in 2008, when the Times story starts. The climate denial machine has been up and running at least since 1988, 20 years longer than the story suggests. He was livid as well that a story on the social aspects of climate discourse didn't cite a single expert. There are hundreds of peer-reviewed articles on the climate denial machine. There are a number of experts, not just him, and of course none of that was cited. So it's a bit frustrating that major media refuses to clearly expose the reality of the undermining of real environmental science, the creation of lies and bribes to distort public policymaking. But again, the work is out there. The problem that I have with that piece, and so it's big political money, says the New York Times. Not the industry, not the Koch brothers, not the laundering of the money, and I'll show another slide a bit. That democratic hubris that Obama is claimed in the second sentence, as the second reason, that, and the argument of the piece is that it was Obama's move into the regulatory approach in his second term that caused Republicans to get so upset and turning. I mean, that's just, you know, as if denialism only started in Obama's second term is ridiculous. And then the idea that this is a bipartisan problem, extreme positions, plural, uncompromising rhetoric on both sides, rather than one that was created by the anti-environmental right. So this is the New York Times failing to expose environmental bullshit. And that, to me, is really frustrating. But the work is out there. There's a lot of work being done on the denial machine, lays out the methodology of the development of environmental distortions and lies and post-truth. So there's some good stuff that's out there. So for me, this is the core example of the evolution of environmental bullshit. There's a long history of the industry creation of lies. There's conservative funding of think tanks. There are front groups. There's this echo chamber. There's the development of an ideological imperative of denialism, which to me is the really crucial step. And then there's the necessity of completely groundless bullshitting by those who don't understand in order to keep that ideological purity. And I'll come back to that. Now, it's not just the US, right? This is one of my favorite posts from Graham Redfern of the Smog blog. The creation of this sort of distortion and lies backed up by this kind of bullshit has been used here in Australia. So there are a lot of arrows and connections, and we can do some of that sort of work between the US groups and the Australian right-wing groups, industries, and politicians. Graham Redfern, who is a journalist and blogger and runs the Smog blog, he's done some of the most amazing work on Australia, sort of tying those links together. The IPA, obviously, is the center of the network in Australia. There is, of course, this different dimension here, the linking to the coal industry and the coal lobbying organizations here, as opposed to sort of the broad right and fossil fuel industry more generally in the US. There's a lot to link specific political actors, not just Malcolm Roberts, but a number of others, to the American Denialist Network. There's been a sharing of information. There's been information tours for Australian politicians in the US run by these right-wing groups. And then, of course, most of the folks on the right here, including the current and the past prime minister, parrot the lies of the industry, parrot the language of the industry, energy poverty, coal is cheap, clean coal is possible, 10,000 jobs, all of these things that we know to be true. This is where Mitchell's work comes in. Mitchell's done some important work on the strategies of Australian mining and energy lobby groups. And in a recent piece, Mitchell and a co-author talk about three different cases, three distinct policy processes, correct me if I'm wrong, where the industry distorts the process and undermines environmental and climate policy. So they deal with the Labour government's attempt to implement the carbon emissions trading scheme and the carbon tax, the broader charm offensive on the part of the mining and energy sector to, quote, cultivate strategic alliances and allies to prevent future legislative challenges, which again mirrors what's happening in the US. So Mitchell's inside expertise on the history of climate denialism and and its origins in the industry is a huge help to this project, and I'm looking forward to working with him. It's another thing I didn't mention at the outset. So this is going to be a big group project. It's not just me. This is one of the reasons why I'm enjoying being a part of the post-truth group. So the point, I guess, of this part of the talk is simply to reiterate the conclusion of the first Outside the Square event, right? That was great that you guys did that survey at Outside the Square asking about this whole post-truth phenomenon. So both before and after the event, people were asked whether post-truth was something new and original or just more of the same as we've had. And I don't know, it was like 60%, 65% at the start, but up to 85% at the end, where people just said, it's the same old shit. Right? This has been happening for a long time. And this is all this part of this talk is saying, is post-truth is nothing new in the environmental arena. This has been going on for quite a
while. It feels like it's amplified with the social media use, though, right?
Such a nice segue. I will come back to that. That is exactly where we're going with this project. So environmentalists have really seen the propagation of lies, the denial of science, the creation of mythologies, and this has been going on. And actually, ExxonMobil is now being sued for it. Right? It's been going on for at least the last 30 years, and it's being parried. Okay, so that's the first part. Is the history. The second part is about how it sort of about, it's not really the theoretical framework, but it's the way that I understand the political use of post-truth. Right? So Matt Iglesias in Vox, and this is the story from Vox last week, he talked about Trump as the bullshitter in chief. And what Iglesias does is take Harry Frankfurt's famous text, and I should have brought that along. If people haven't read Harry Frankfurt's little book on bullshit, it's a great piece. It was really helpful for me when I was chairing an academic department a while ago, because people really do use the tactics that he lays out in there. So Iglesias is using Frankfurt's framework. He actually doesn't cite another important work that was done in January by an academic. This is Lauren Griffin, who's an academic at the University of Florida, who talks about the difference between lies and bullshit. This is what Frankfurt's book is all about. It's about the difference between lies and bullshit. What's the difference between a lie and bullshit, or a liar and a bullshitter? And a bullshitter, says Griffin, and this comes out of Frankfurt, a bullshitter doesn't care whether the things he says or she describes reality correctly. He just picks them out or makes them up to suit his purpose. The liars are actually interested in the truth. The whole point of a lie is to obfuscate the truth. So you have to understand the truth in order to lie, but bullshitters just couldn't care less. Bullshitters are just saying what makes them look good, what makes their case. They're more interested in impressions than they are in actively trying to conceal the truth, which is what liars are doing. So the energy industry, the climate denial machine, they are dedicated, manipulative, self-interested liars, destroyers of truth. They know the truth, and they actively create an alternate reality, a post-truth. Trump, on the other hand, and a lot of other politicians are just bullshitters. They don't really care about the truth or even know enough to differentiate the facts from the fiction. They're just saying shit that they believe will gain them favor or believe fits into an ideological framework. So again, I'm a fan of Frankfurt's book and I've used it, but in the context of climate denialism, and this is the crucial thing for me, I'm not so sure that differentiating between lies on the one hand and bullshit on the other is enough. I think we need to bring a more sort of systematic or cyclical, maybe even dialectical approach to understanding the relationship. And so what I'm seeing in the climate and energy space, particularly around fossil fuels, repeated here in Australia around coal production and the health of the Great Barrier Reef, among other things, is something that starts as deliberate lies, that keeps being produced and circulated as deliberate lies, and then gets repeated in an echo chamber. And that's the circulation of very conscious and consciously constructed lies. But there's something that happens before we get to the bullshit. At some point, strong ideological belief comes into the picture, right? Ideological belief in the lies. The lies are originally developed for economic reasons, right? They're developed for to avoid policy that will harm the industry in some way. But the belief in them, the belief in the lies, has become an ideological litmus test for the right. So this is a really simple, and this to me is one of the single most depressing graphs about the US over the last 30 years. So this is basically the League of Conservation Voters, one of the major environmental organizations in the US, scoring representatives on their environmental voting in Congress. So you can see early in the 1970s, the differences between Democrats in blue and Republicans in red really isn't that much. Starting, and this is crucial, starting in the 80s, and this is where the climate denial machine begins, you start to see this huge differentiation. So there's an ideological divide now between Democrats and Republicans on environment. So it's not just lies, and it's not just bullshit. It has become ideology. Right? That is, and we're seeing the same sort of thing here in Australia. So it becomes a litmus test. Right? It becomes a litmus test for the right. It becomes a duty of conservatives to stand up and repeat lies. But here's where the bullshit comes in, because as most people just don't understand the nature of the issue, don't understand the difference between truth and the deception, as the originators of the lies did, that's where the bullshit comes in. So you get a lot of ideological representatives spouting bullshit because they don't understand the difference between lies and the truth, but they know that they have to spout it in order to be ideologically true to their position. So it's not the lies that necessarily spawn the bullshit. Right? It's the idealization of the lies and the sense of adherence to that ideology, for me, that gets people to start spouting shit. So that's where we get Trump, that's where we get Malcolm Roberts, that's where we get Tony Abbott, that's where we get Caravan, that's where we get a number of people spouting stuff that they don't truly understand. It's internally inconsistent, it's contradictory from one day to the next. It's an element of ideological speech that makes sense to others, that adhere to the ideology, even if it doesn't make sense in a more general sense. So the point here, and I've said this since since we started this whole endeavor on post-truth, I'm less interested in the bullshit than I am in the origins of the lies. Right? So I want to trace things back to where they start. I'm not even all that interested in how lies, I should be, as a political scientist, I should be interested in how the lies become ideology. I think that's a core question that is really understudied and needs more exploration. I think without that, we'll have a lot less, or with that kind of study, we have a lot less bullshit. But for me, the key thing is the origins of the lies. Sorry. So I guess as an aside here, one of the issues here related to the growth and maintenance of lies as ideology and the spread of the bullshit is the creation of enemies. Reminded of Donald Trump Jr.'s, was it Donald Trump or Eric Trump yesterday, who said, "I don't understand all this hatred of my father. I don't even think those people, I don't even think they're people." What? Well, it's this incredible quote where he dehumanizes the entire, anybody who is opposed to the Republican platform. They're not human, right? They're not people. So this whole idea of the creation of enemies, and again, Lauren Griffin points this out in her earlier piece in January, anyone who tries to correct Trump, right? Anyone trying to correct the lies of the industry or the bullshit of Trump or the ideological sort of loyalty becomes an enemy. So scientists are the enemy. Civil servants who've worked on these issues are the enemy. Journalists who try to correct the lies and point out the bullshit are the enemy. Muslim mayors of major cities are the enemy. Environmentalists, of course, are the enemy and the scapegoat. All other countries, all other politicians that hold to the truth of climate change or any other lie-based ideological issue like the Muslim ban, right, they're enemies. So the idea is that there are enemies everywhere, and this whole idea that there are enemies everywhere becomes part of the ideology, which spawns a whole other level of more personal bullshit. I've lost my place. I did. So, this is just another example. Sorry, it's not in the talk. This is just another example of the climate denial machine. You probably can't see a lot of this. This is basically the funding of denial. The squares are where the money comes from. The blue circles are where the money goes. These are some of the think tanks. You'll notice there's this one very large blue. This is a US map of the denial, of the funding of the denial industry. This is something called the Donors Trust or the Donors Capital Fund. For people that know about the Koch brothers, they no longer directly fund a lot of their climate denial. A lot of money from a lot of these groups, and it's really too bad that this is a snapshot as opposed to a historical shift. A lot of this money is basically, it's a blind, it's a donor's trust. It's money that one can't, hate touch screens. That's all you have to do is the money is blind now, so the Kochs still give a ton of money to climate denial. It doesn't go through their own foundation, it goes through the Donors Trust. So there's the money is hidden. And in part, that's to sort of obfuscate further the whole the whole industry. Okay, so moving on from there, there's a lot of talk about, and this actually comes out today, in some of the stuff that's going on in the U.S., about Trump's bullshit in the U.S. now becoming a lot about loyalty. This is what Iglesias was actually talking about in his piece. It's basically, for him, it's about just sort of spouting bullshit and then see who stands behind you. It's not about lying for Trump, says Iglesias. It's about just who's going to stay loyal to him no matter what he says. But I don't really think that's the important part of understanding the role of lies and bullshit in environmental policy or even in this administration. For me, it's not about Trump, it's not about Tillerson, it's not about Pruitt, it's not about Ebel, it's not about any of these people in the US. We can give the same sort of figures here. So Tillerson, Pruitt, and Ebel are all longtime figures in this climate denial machine who are now major figures in the administration. They're now in positions of political power and influence. So trying to figure out how to think about that. So you do have now the liars, the origins of the lies, those that created the lies in the administration who are using the ideology and the bullshit to keep. And that sort of loyalty idea, all of this is coming together in a really ugly mix in the US. So it's still about lies as ideology, it's still about bullshit as ideology, it's about loyalty to ideology, and for me it's about the funding, it's about the origins of all this. And I still think we can use Frankfurt to distinguish different parts of what's actually going on. We know, and I think this is crucial, we know lies are propagated in this space, and there's a long history of that, and I think that's what we need to keep our eye on. So I guess one of the heartening things for me is that there is a growing amount of work being done in this space, not just the stuff that I showed. There's the great network analysis of the machine that I showed. A lot of the funders and Bob Relay has done a ton of work on that. I think it's great. There's a lot more mainstream media, if not the New York Times, doing some more work on this. And we've seen an increasing focus on the shift to ideology. I think that was actually part of what the Times was trying to get at, is how ideological this has become, even if they trace it to Obama and not before. That's another thanks, Obama, for that. So that's basically the framework that I'm thinking about in terms of developing a project, right, for this group. It's to get at this relationship between lies, ideology, and bullshit, but to do it over time. Okay, so that's my good line. Who controls the shit box? I mean, we're trying to. So now we're getting to, you know, some of the social media stuff, and I'm trying to think of a good name to call some of these groups. So there's a lot of traditional work on the climate denial machine that I've mentioned. It's a really hard slog. It's a lot of work. You follow the money. You follow where individuals are. You follow, you know, who's on what board. And then, you, of course, you follow the language from the think tank to whoever tends to spout it. But one of the nice things about this is that there are lots of new tools being used to... Not a nice thing. One of the things that we know is going on is there are a lot of new tools being used to spread the lies and to turn them into ideology. There are more tools in social media that spread these ideas that people don't care are untrue because they're ideologically on point. And we've seen a tactical shift in the toolbox of the denial machine with the growth of social media. So that's getting back to the point earlier. So earlier, the focus of the denial campaign was on broad public discourse, ownership of conservative representatives, and that was done with a lot of planting of stories in the media, the development of a whole sort of set of denialist discourses, right? It's not happening, the science is uncertain, well, maybe it's happening, but humans don't do it, scientists get paid to do this, it's a global left-wing conspiracy, that still comes up all the time. World government is coming for your children, you know, all of that kind of stuff. So those sort of talking points. But as we've seen, well, for a while, but it really came to the public fore with the US election, it's much easier to spread prefabricated lies in concerted campaigns via social media. And those lies get quickly reworked, retweeted, and increasingly botted in some very targeted ways. So one of the ways that I'm trying to understand what's happening here is to sort of use some of this work that's being done on the denial machine to differentiate a couple of different important components. So Dunlop and McWright talk about the difference between an idea infrastructure and an influence infrastructure, and I think this is crucial. So in the climate denial machine, there was the development of the language, the development of the ideas from the big conservative think tanks funded by the financial infrastructure. Those have been supplanted in some way by media organizations like Breitbart, which then get propagated. But then there's that influence infrastructure. So again, in the denial machine earlier on, it was the lobbyists, it was those who were tasked with pushing legislators toward particular positions. It also entailed the creation of AstroTurf organizations to influence voters. And so there was a whole influence campaign after the development of the lies, then you're trying to influence people and get the ideology to work to bring people on board. So for our purposes, the trick is finding the links between the original lies and that later adherence to the subsequent bullshit. And that's where we think some of the new social media scraping tools might be useful. So the question is still simple, right? The question is still, where do the lies come from? And at what point do they become an ideological statement, given the status of some of the retweeters? So I'm going to show... Yes, please. This has nothing to do with our example. This is a time series Twitter map. It'll pop up. Of a single hashtag having to do with health politics in the UK. And again, this is not something I've done before. I don't do this kind of work. I don't do that kind of mapping. My wife saw this last night and she said, I want to embroider that. She wants to make pillows of these network maps. So this is where, again, the group is going to come in. So what we plan to do is to choose specific issues, specific events related to the Great Barrier Reef, and then analyze the Twitterverse that emerges out of those issues over time. So most of the Twitter scraping focuses on a single point in time, mostly at the end. Right? So here is a map of the Twitter response to this particular event, and it's a single point in time. I'm not interested in that. We want to see the evolution from the beginning, so the very beginning of this, right? Where did they come from? And then where do they go? Where do they go? So this is the idea is to get at the idea infrastructure, where the obfuscation comes from, and then identify the points over time where those ideas are reworked and retweeted as part of the influence infrastructure. So, and not all of this is individuals like you and me retweeting or liking. We know that tweet bots are the new thing. We know in the US election and elsewhere, it's used to take original ideas to a whole other level of influence. So we're looking for the equivalent of, we're looking for the equivalent of AstroTurf organizations in the Twittersphere. We're trying to decide whether to call them AstroBots or ShitBots. AstroBots is actually probably already trademarked. It's a kid's coding game. I'm actually looking this up. AstroBot. It's a kid's coding game, but it's also an AI email manager. So we probably don't want to go there. So I think we'll go with ShitBot. There's nothing. I think it's
no
a character. ShitBot is a character in some science fiction book, but that's okay. We can deal with that. But look, this is really crucial stuff. We know, and we're going to look at this, right? We know, for example, the week before Trump announced his pulling out of the climate accord out of Paris, he had 5 million new followers on his Twitter account. The vast majority of them were bots. And people were trying to figure out, well, what's about to drop? What are those bots going to do? And to me, this is a really fascinating political topic. And so that's what we want to sort of trace on, especially in Australia and around the Great Barrier Reef. The use of that sort I want to say bullshit infrastructure, but it's not bullshit, right? It's a lie infrastructure, and it's this translation from lie to ideology and ideological adherence that you want to look at. So we plan on starting fairly small on a very localized event that created a bit of ideological kerfuffle, might be the word. This is the polluting of the wetlands at an Adani-run port after Debbie. So there was this initial satellite photo, for example, right? There was this initial satellite photograph that was tweeted by an environmental organization that illustrated the before and after of this wetland. That's not really the best picture, is it? That's not the best. There are better pictures. Fairly quickly, though, we had a lot of people tweeting this wasn't real, it was magnetite, it wasn't coal. It was a crappy duck pond. That's Barnaby Joyce, right? It's just a duck pond rather than a wetland. So in short, there was immediately, and this is a really small scale event, but there was this Twitter storm that came out of it. And so we want to trace the utterances and the evolution of tweets around particular events having to do with the Great Barrier Reef. And this is just one example of that. We want to go a bit more broad in the application of the methodology. In other discussions, other Twitter storms around the reef, around the Adani coal mine, around bleaching events, around storm events. So the project will entail this sort of Twitter scraping about events over time in order to get at the origins of the various utterances and discourse. We want to see who or what picks up and tweets or retweets what messages. We want to see how the lies flow through the Twitter sphere and into and out of political discourse to trace those utterances. And not for the linguistic tics. Sorry, Nick's not here, so I can. It's not about the linguistic tics. It's not about the hints of whether someone's changed their mind about something. It's not really about, it's not about bullshit. It's about the origins of lies in an industry-sponsored attack on the truth. So the method is supposed to get at the lead actors, it's supposed to get at the chains, at the initiators, and the amplifiers. That's another way to put it, the data flow. So in short, the bulls, who are the bulls creating all of this shit about the reef, right? And where is the shit coming from? What are the shit bots that are spreading it. Is that the right? I'm going to use that. I don't know if Brand will let me say that out loud.
Yeah, you can do that.
So again, as I've said from the start of this project, that's what I'm interested in, right? The bulk, the origin, the propagators, not the performers. I'm not interested in the performers of the bullshit, the performers at the front end. I want to go into the God, the back end and the shit. It just doesn't work. Sorry. So that's what we're interested in responding to the post-truth world, right? Going back and tracing, exposing those that purposefully, that actively, that destructively undermine the real claims of environmental science. So that's where I am. Ask me questions. I've got it. Yes.
Well, I just had a general question on your distinction between bullshit, lies, and ideology.
Yes, please.
Oh, that's the question.
Is that a question?
Well, characterize them? Like, I mean, it's a real question. It's not. I'm just wondering.
All I'm doing there is. So this is. Can I answer that question? Frankfurt's a philosopher, right? And Frankfurt is laying out this difference, and I think it's a really important distinction between lies and bullshit. And I think that holds really well. The difference between people who understand the nature of the truth and actively distort it, that's a liar,
okay, right.
And the bullshitters who have no idea what the hell they're talking about.
So what's the ideology?
The ideology part is, that's the crucial political part for me, and that's the part where the lies actually catch on and become something that one has to be loyal to, right? And it becomes part of a political identity. And that's the part that I'm curious about, because I think there's a reason why people bullshit, because they think that they have to say something that's ideologically aligned, but they don't know the difference between the lie and the truth.
In fact, in the with this understanding of ideology, the sort of axioms of an ideology can be lies or not lies. The question is not whether they're lies; it's just that they are set statements that build up an ideology, right?
So I wouldn't say that these are an ideology. Talking about the trans, okay. Right? So this isn't about an ideology. It's about ideological adherence. And I think there's a difference there.
But
this is one, I mean, this is something else that we can get at. You know, how conservatism in the U.S. as an ideology has moved in this direction. I think that's a really important question. That's not the question I'm asking. The question I'm asking is, who are the players that have shifted this idea of ideology, this ideological adherence, to these particular lies?
To these particular statements that happen to be lies.
That are constructed purposefully as lies.
Yeah, yes. But would you call it, some political adherence that is linked to statements which, according to you, are not lies, would you call that an ideology?
Ideology, there's a whole range. Yeah, again, I'm not talking about the definition of ideology. I'm talking about ideological adherence as part of the spectrum between lies and bullshit.
Yeah, that's.
Yeah. David, thank you so much. Genuine question about the money trail in US politics, campaign donations.
Yeah.
So in Australia, over the last 5 years, we sort of tried to map all of the contributions from the energy and minerals lobby. And due to Australia's disclosure laws, we could get those that were actually made by major corporations, but we started to discover a few anomalies where you've got multinationals, BHP and others, who are making very small contributions, where the smaller local companies making much larger ones. And when we start to dig into that, it seems like that there might be a way to bypass Australia's electoral donation regulations by sort of giving money to a third party group, and so then that third party group makes a contribution on your behalf, and so it doesn't show up.
Yeah.
Like,
that's exactly what the donors trust is in the US.
Okay. Yeah.
That's how the donors trust acts. Because you don't have to declare a donation to the donors trust. Right. So it's basically a money laundering.
Yeah.
You know, it's an anonymizer.
Yeah. So there's no sort of electoral laws in the US that actually allow you to identify all of the money that's coming from these groups.
I don't know the answer to that. It's just not my area of expertise. Yeah.
Thanks, sorry for being a bit late. I wonder with your talk, and I thought this before coming, just to be clear, I was here 26 years ago doing a higher degree, and at the time, a number of us went down and got arrested at the Tanderlin Valley State Forest in a protest against the logging, and as a young person, I was quite active in the environmental movement. And what I despair of now with the discussion of climate change is that there were, I remember David Bellamy coming down here for the Gordon Blair Franklin ban, I remember a big protest against APM in Tasmania and so on, and many of my friends were involved. And I don't see any of that anymore, and instead environmentalists have been distracted into a conversation about the weather. And I think that we're in a state of hyper-reality where, there's bullshit on both sides, and it's so thick that I wonder if that's not the game, that the bullshit is so thick on both sides that people despair of it, as I am starting to, because when I look at, for example, what happened with Julia Gillard, the Loy Yang Power Station got $450 million from the government to deal with climate change, and then they jacked up their prices for everyone in Victoria, and then within a year, they were no longer required to do that. They never gave back the money, and they kept their prices up, and then they started offering sort of nominal discounts to users. And I see, actually, there's this huge corporate welfare thing that's going to industry under the guise of climate. So I see it working two ways. When I look at, I read a report about Elon Musk, how he's had $3.5 billion given to SolarCity, and he's loaned a lot of that money from SolarCity into Tesla. So the free money that SolarCity has got is keeping Tesla afloat. And Al Gore's the first climate billionaire. Yeah. Without being cynical, I'm definitely on the side of climate.
Without being cynical.
I'm despairing. Well, I'm not being cynical. When you look at the facts and leave the ideology behind, you have to say, I question the integrity of all of these people. And I just wonder, and when I see no direct action at all on any important issue.
It's maybe true in Australia, but for instance, in France, it's happening exactly the same way as 30 years ago. People are on site, involved, they get arrested sometimes, they get killed. So it may be an Australian thing that's what's happening.
Yeah, I think people would say the same thing. I mean, in terms of the shift in activism, or away from putting bodies on the line. But I think a lot of that particular thing, it's just a critique of the theater of it all, right? I mean, a lot of direct action became theater. It was, the police would draw a line and people would either cross it or not and get arrested or not, and what did it actually do? So I think there's been some this is some of the work that I do on environmental movement strategies. I think there's just been more of a focus on ways of articulating campaigns in a way that will actually get something done as opposed to just standing in the way. But that said, there's going to be a lot of activism if there's some ground broken on the Carmichael line. It'll be just like Franklin. I have no doubt about that. On the political stuff, I'm not going to disagree at all that I'm assuming what you mean by both sides is the conservative side and the labor side. And it's the same thing in the U.S., where a lot of, and this is why nothing got done, nothing thorough got done on climate while Obama had both sides of the House in the first couple of years, because they couldn't get it through. And it's like what Trump is finding now, right? Even his own party won't let him get things through. It's the same thing with Obama, and because they're bought. There's a lot of money that flows in. That's how people get elected. I don't have any disagreement about that. I think that's a different set of issues than what we're talking about here. Here I'm really interested, and I don't think there's any difference between 30 years ago and now in terms of the fact that industry is trying to influence public opinion, and they're trying to influence political opinion, and they're trying to get some sort of ideological adherence to favoring the industry in some way. That hasn't changed. The way that it's being done is changing, and that's what I'm interested in. And I actually think, I think it's easier now to trace that kind of obfuscation and influence. I think it's easier to, to get at those infrastructures now than it was in the past.
I actually didn't really agree with that point. I just think we need to be very careful, because I think there are savvy people in industry who are quite adept at playing both sides. So there's sort of the bull, they can spin the bullshit.
Well, that's where the Musk thing comes in.
Yeah. And I think, you know, if the environmental movement wants to be successful, we need to be very wary of that.
Yeah.
David, I wondered what you thought about the fact that a lot of big multinationals headquartered in the States actually wrote a letter to Trump after the election about the treaty and said American business needs the States to be part of the climate treaty, the Paris Climate Treaty, for them because of the market, because of the green technologies. So I'm just wondering how that you think that plays out, considering that he says he's pulled out of Paris for American business.
Yeah.
Yet there is this other, you know, it's also a market opportunity. And where do you think
I think different businesses have different reasons for wanting to remain in Paris. I think clearly some of them are authentically saying this can be good for the development of new energy sources and jobs in the U.S. So there's that. But I think folks like Tillerson wanted the U.S. at the table in order to continue to do what the U.S. has done, which is to undermine more thorough treaties and more thorough responses. The U.S. has been at the table, you know, this is what's been happening from the first Bush era, to slow down the process, to make it incredibly difficult to actually come to an agreement. And I think that's what Tillerson was aiming for, was to undermine some of the next steps in the Paris Accord. And, I mean, this is what Luke Kemp wrote about a couple of weeks ago from the ANU. It might be a better thing that Trump pulled out, because at least it's honest, right? We're not going to do anything, right? And now it comes down to companies and to specific companies and to states and cities and all that. I think this is where you'll see the difference between those who are thinking authentically, right, and do want to actually do something, and those that were just lying about their interest and who won't.
Yeah, might be his Brexit. Well, he's not at the table anymore. They're not at the table anymore.
Yeah.
They can't influence if they're not there.
Which could be a very good thing, given how much influence the U.S. has had. I mean, the whole Paris Accord was designed in such a way, in a voluntary way, because there's no way that it could have gotten past the U.S. Congress.
Yeah.
And so it's all voluntary, specifically to deal with the problems in the U.S. Right? So it would have been, without a doubt, it would have been a stronger treaty had the U.S. been involved.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Maybe it'll be that again.
So, David, with the weak points in a democratic system, you know, marginal seats and post-industrial cities in the U.S., is there any sort of evidence that these lobby groups are using sophisticated targeting to, you know, because obviously bullshit has to resonate if it's going to be effective, and so I'm guessing more different communities are more susceptible to that than others. Is it a targeted...
And that's a really good question, and that would be, I mean, this is why it's frustrating where we can't examine Facebook as we do Twitter, because Facebook, you can really target, right? But of course, we can't scrape Facebook because it's not open and public as Twitter is. I mean, so there's a lot, you know, stuff that's being written on the U.S. election about the use of Facebook and, you know, and doing exactly that, targeting particular demographics, targeting particular seats, target particular areas and spreading disinformation about the polls being open or closed or what people's voting, just to try and throw people off. So there's a lot of that happened absolutely in the last election, but again, it's more through Facebook because it's the demographics are easier to target there than Twitter, which is just sent everywhere.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, that's
a
true to a certain extent, but I think that the issue is a bit more complex in the way that we're concerned about environmentalism, but that's if you start losing votes, that people vote on a whole range of issues, not only environmental, social, economic levers too, and the way social media like Facebook have targeted people is, you know, they're pushing your buttons on your pet project, which you might be in favour of climate change, doing something about climate change, but there's something else, you know, like Brexit, it's the migrant issue, which is a bigger pull, so you end up voting.
Yeah. Or environmental things are painted as harming the other things that you vote for, right? So they harm jobs, or harms development, and you're not.
And
I think that's going to shift.
Sifting out.
Yeah, but I really do think that's shifting. I think, and this is what I said in response to Trump's announcement, I think the ethical, the economic, and the political factors are coming together, where it's easier now to say to people in Queensland, for example, we know, because Adani has said, it's going to be almost entirely automated. There aren't going to be any jobs.
Mm-hmm.
But we also know the growth of jobs in the US and China and elsewhere is coming in the renewables industry. So jobs is the thing you're looking for. It's in this particular industry, not in this.
Mm-hmm.
And the health issue is the other one. People vote on health. And the more information that comes out, and this is something that that hasn't been, that but that will be talked about in the U.S. Some of the rules that the Obama administration passed were done in order, well, were done because of the laws that allow the EPA to protect the public health. And so the mercury rule, which is one of the rules that was for the use of mercury or the emissions of mercury, which is part of coal emissions. That was used as a way, the knowledge about the impact on public health was used as a way to justify more regulations on the emissions in coal plants. And the evidence that came out, you know, it's about 10,000 deaths a year, something like that, hundreds of thousands of cases of childhood asthma. People care about that.
Mm.
And there's a lot of that information, especially in Australia, around coal, all the information that's out there about the rise in asthma rates, of children along the rail lines down the country. I mean, it's there, and that kind of information. And this is what's changing the nature of the political discussion in China. It's what's going to change the nature of the political discussion in India. It's the public health, because people do vote for that, even if they don't vote for environment more generally. That's a basic thing.
Yeah, but there's still this disconnect between what the public thinks and what how politicians act, which is this huge bridge.
Yeah.
And even though politicians might lose some votes, that they maintain their safe seats. You know, the US, I'm trying to be an optimist. I think I'm an optimist, but I feel that you need some catastrophe before people kind of wake up and go, well, we've got to do something. But with the US, you know, we had Cyclone Katrina, and you think, well, wasn't that a wake-up call? But it wasn't. It's a bit like the gun lobby. You have a massacre of school kids, and you think, well, surely they have to say something, but nothing happens.
Mm.
And I think the general public are kind of saying, yes, we want action, but it's not getting through to the politicians.
Yeah.
Like
a mass breaching event.
The death of the reef.
It's interesting, though, because when you know, Four Corners or 7:30 report this week went to Bowen, and they talked to, you know, local townspeople about Adani, and you know, the local business people are staking the future of the town on Adani. And that is a disconnect in Australia where politicians particularly forget about rural Australia. And this is something that I think is a really big factor in this debate. I wonder whether, well, I think it is the same in the States based on the voting patterns and things, isn't it? It's this marginalisation, or this perceived marginalisation, well, it's actually very real. It's not perceived.
Yeah.
It's a marginalisation of real people. Yeah. They
Barnaby
just feel
Joyce
like they don't get it.
Barnaby Joyce hasn't forgotten about that.
We laugh about Barnaby Joyce.
Yeah,
and we laugh about Bob Catter, but I come from Queensland. These people, they make sense up there.
They do, yeah.
And if you live in a town where there aren't any jobs anymore, and it's not right in your backyard, just kind of in your backyard, it's a really compelling case, and I can totally see how the tactics work.
Well, another case, like, this is the spotted owl thing. Like, I mean sorry, it's just I wonder, like, you know, I think you have to be in a very, very strong position in life without, you know, any suffering for your job or any concern to be able to think that it's completely fine and that we should fight for a spotted owl to get that much of forest.
That's what a lot of people would have said.
But look, so one of the things, So this is a little different than what we're trying to do. You know, we're
sure.
But let me differentiate. So the project is really about sort of tracing some of this language back. But the language is crucial. And so what what you're sort of talking about now is the language that the movement groups are using or not using in order to appeal to people. That's a whole other really crucial idea. And I've written on this as well, and the kinds of campaigns and language around campaigns that are successful versus aren't. And you know, the outcome of this, this is a book right over a decade ago, is finding that whenever environmental groups can actually argue that they are appealing to the imperatives of states, what states are responsible for doing, economic growth, public safety and health, all these things, that's when they're successful. So in the forest wars and the timber wars, one of the most successful things that the environmental movement did was argue for a ban of the export of raw logs. So they moved from the cutting of the trees to the export, because it's something that they could get local people on board, right? Why should we take these huge, valuable trees and just put them on a boat and send them to Japan or China? Why don't we keep that wood here and build a value-added industry? Right? Let's talk about cabinet making and furniture making and all kinds of it. We can do this with this wood. We don't have to just send the raw material. And talking in that way, meeting that sort of economic development imperative of the state, they got a lot of sympathy. And it was the first time in that whole battle where you had union members and environmentalists together on the docks protesting the export of raw logs. And you can do the same sort of thing here. And I think the whole just transition idea that's finally taking root here, where you actually have a group like Greenpeace, which is hated viscerally in Queensland, talking about just transition and jobs, and the Australian Institute's doing a lot more of that. So I think that's absolutely crucial. That's the sort of discourse and the sort of action, if it's done authentically, that actually gets people on your side.
Yeah.
I think the public health stuff will do that as well.
Yeah. Well, the movements are guilty of a lot of obviously the same framing tactics, because you have to have the enemy. You have to simplify the message. So that's why it's easier for the media to create the protest paradigm, because it's a simplified framing of a complex issue.
Yeah.
But I think what are the conditions that make the audience receptive to the arguments really, really interests me. Because we do sit here in these, they are ideological battles, they're different worldviews, they're different ways of thinking about different life experiences, exactly. So, you know, it's got a lot to do with the political conditions that make you either receptive or resistant to all those different framings.
I can already feel it here.
Yeah.
I'm in that temporary position that I think that, you know, gives a very different perspective to my understanding. Sorry, I keep repeating this, but I think it cannot get really completely pushed out of the debate. But I did have a question on the way things are framed. So going back to history, so you said that about the housekeeping, municipality housekeeping thing. You said, that the lie about it was propagated by the polluting industry. So at the time, how did this work practically? Because there wasn't, it wasn't Twitter, it wasn't Facebook. So I'm wondering, by which means?
Yeah, it's old media.
Media. So at the time, the newspapers.
Unmasking the women. In order to put up, but it's also the industry influence on. It's a really good question, and there are a couple of books about this sort of early history, and I don't know if they actually get into that. But I mean, most of it has to do with putting off regulations, especially zoning. Are you going to move the abattoirs out of the city? Was one of the main things, right? Because that was. And this is where zoning laws came into it. That's the origin of zoning laws in the U.S. Is this response to municipal housekeeping? So.
What
public planning?
One experience I thought at the EPA when I was there was this idea of grandfathering. So you might have an industry which was relatively dirty, and then they want to bring in new regulation.
Yeah.
And there was always this obsession to try and argue against about grandfathering and old industry, because you know, you can't possibly get these jobs even though they're doing environmental damage, but you penalise the newcomers and eventually the old, you know, the old companies we have to upgrade or
And again, that's one of the things the US did, right?
Yeah.
The Clean Air Act, even when it was passed, it grandfathered in existing coal plants.
There was, in a way, that's an ideology too, is that you can't hurt the existing players. You've got to protect the old industries, and you can impose high standards on the new industries.
Sort of a natural attrition.
But it never quite works out like that.
Yeah.
You see, that's why I always argued against it, is that, you know, you're saying these will go out of business, but that, you know, we'll upgrade, but that's 20, 30 years down the track, you know. Why aren't we imposing some sort of restrictions now?
Australia doesn't like innovation.
Yeah. And they keep talking
change
about the level playing field, but they create these uneven playing fields and sort of, you know, you've got a uneven playing field when you're being penalised or you're facing competition.
Yeah. It's interesting to compare it with, I mean, this is off the topic of this, but it's interesting to compare it to some, you know, policies elsewhere. So the state of California, for example, I think in their statewide building regulations, there's something about best practice. Right? So basically, whatever the best technology is that exists at a particular cost, becomes the regulation. Right? So you're constantly improving. And then there's, of course, the competition among businesses to create a more efficient window or more efficient rooftop or, you know, more efficient insulation, because that'll be part of the next regulation. So, and you just create this improvement. This is why California's population is going like this, but its energy use has been like this for the past 30 years. One more.
I'm interested in your comments about, you know, the cognitive dissonance that goes on. So you have a lie.
Assuming there is, yeah.
You're certainly a mismatch in some of the things that people say, like David Roberts. So you've got this lie goes to ideology, and you've got the bullshit that sort of propagates out there. Now, you talk about it in two contexts, in the US and in Australia. That could be because those are the two places that you are most familiar with.
Yes.
It could also be two places where this sort of behaviour is perhaps most prominent. And what that takes me back to is, as you will be not at all surprised about where I'm going now, is that both states have been founded on ideologies based in lies. So, is it easier for us in these two states to hold these inconsistent ideas in our head, to actually be bamboozled by ideology easily, because we have to do that anyway to justify our positions within, you know, as primarily white people sitting around this table. As white people in these states, we have to sit with this sort of
discomfort. Yeah.
And bullshit it away in our heads. So when another set of lies and constructed ideology comes along, we are actually open to it.
Maybe. I mean, all you need there is
an interesting part of what you could be doing.
So we're more susceptible because it's happened in a number of ways. Yeah, but I mean, and I don't know if you'll ever find a counterfactual there, right?
Well, I just wonder about the European counterfactual. You know, you take Germany, France, etc., where they're happily in embracing.
Well, there may not have been a colonizing event, but there's certainly histories of lies and bullshit.
Sure, and haven't they actively been moving towards dismantling the sorts of structures that allow those lies and bullshit to rest within.
I don't know if you're.
I don't know about that.
I mean, really just reading about the British election, there's plenty of bullshit.
Sure, there is, but remember, Britain is the one that created the US and Australia. So the UK, I think, is possibly the source of
There's just as much bullshit in France. It's
But she hasn't got the traction that Trump
I
think that's because of the electional system of how the election works, but I think she could definitely get elected.
But
she's
got 50%.
Look, this is
I think that's going to happen.
But the other thing is to look at the flip side, right? What is it that actually resists bullshit?
Mm-hmm.
Right? So what is a positive factor in a political culture that resists that?
Mm-hmm.
When I first moved here, I mean, Australia, I think this is hilarious, but when I first moved here, this was when Abbott, as opposition leader, was attacking Garneau,
mm-hmm.
right? And then attacked the entire discipline of economics. And that's what I heard plenty of. I mean, that was my life in Arizona, right? Politicians attacking academics as completely out of touch and, all of this. But the backlash against Abbott at that point, where he had to apologize to Garneau, right? I was just blown away. And that the chief scientist, which, of course, we didn't have in Arizona, what the hell is that, right? That you have a chief scientist and that called out an opposition leader that then had to apologize for this sort of denigration of a truth teller. That was amazing to me. That was just something that's long gone in the US. So I think there's a bit more here, maybe, or was, where there is that ability to resist that kind of idealization of the bullshit.
But also, it's a matter of style. So there's the ballot system that makes things different. So Marine Le Pen didn't make him this time in France. But it's interesting that Macron, I mean, have you ever listened to one of his speeches? He just doesn't say anything. It's pure vacuum.
We like
and
that
that's,
too.
But that's how he won. Like,
Certainly.
It's not, it's possibly less dangerous, but it's still bullshit. So I don't think, it's... Yeah.
He just had to say, I'm not a fascist, and he would have won.
Well, I think we are great. That's what he says. It's a bit like it's also not well, like Obama as well.
It's one of the strengths and weaknesses of a democratic system, right? Because ideology here is about hegemony. You have to win consent in order to govern. They don't have these discussions in China because there's no public sphere, no civil society. So, one question to think about: will China be the saviour now that the world's sort of most powerful democracy has walked away from the table?
But the public health issue in China has just really taken off. And it is partly the economic development stuff, but it's public health. That was the first thing that started pushing the Chinese government towards renewables. That shift of energy is absolutely crucial because people were getting upset. There was unrest around public health and around pollution. And the same thing's going to happen in India.
Well, this goes back to your point that there's a crisis. You go outside and you can't breathe. Mm-hmm. You do something. And if you've got a one-party government, you can do stuff. You don't have to worry. You can make amazing.
Environmentalists have been talking about the potential
targets
of China for decades, right? That's authoritarianism would actually be a really good thing for environmentalism if they just did the right thing. And that's exactly what China's doing. Right?
It's
changing on a dime and now taking leadership.
But it's a quick shift, right? Because it was only in 2009 that Kevin Rudd, our prime minister, described them, or we won't say it on record because it's rather colourful language. You can remember how we described during the Copenhagen, so because the Chinese sabotaged Copenhagen,
right.
So Kevin Rudd.
I've erased Kevin Rudd from my memory.
Yeah, and he led, so we were very close to getting a really solid international agreement in 2009.
Right.
The Chinese sabotaged it. Yeah. They sabotaged it because it wasn't in their industrial.
Oh, that's right, he called them rat something, didn't he?
Yeah,
it
did.
Yeah. I remember now.
So I'm sort of a little bit skeptical or cynical regarding whether or not China will step up and provide the global leadership.
People feel the same way about India. You've got the Prime Minister and the Energy Minister on the same page.
If it's in China's economic interest to advance their industry and their standing, then
central state imperatives, right? Public protection and economic development.
Yeah.
Keep
the revolutionaries in their place if everybody else is happy.
Well, hopefully we'll have more to talk about after we actually do some of this project, when we get permission from ethics.
I think there's also a dimension to this, this sort of public apathy, or cynicism of politicians on all sides.
Well, that's
probably that's been brought up. Mm-hmm. But you know, we have local action like, you know, shut the gate when it fits your backyard. The rest of the population is kind of go, well, it's a concern. I think that climate change is sort of, because it's bigger than being here, people think, oh, it's, what can I do? You know, I'm only one voice and get shut now, I'll live in lions.
Well, this is another question is about the disconnect between public opinion, which is often pro-environmental more generally. Mm. Even in the US, the majority didn't want to pull out of the climate accord.
Mm.
But the disconnect between that and the ideology of the parties.
Yeah. But I think that even the Greens party here, that's not sure whether my view is sort of representative, but people feel disillusioned by them, because we could have had an emission trading scheme under Julia Gillard, but they sabotaged it because it wasn't ideologically pure enough.
Mm.
And going, well, we've actually ended up in a far worse situation than we could have had, you know. No,
I think anybody ever forgive the Greens for that.
But actually, you know, that's the point. Well, I think that your topic of sort of synthetic bullshit, it's actually a structural feature of dealing with issues at a super macro level.
Yeah.
And in the end, the bullshit is on all sides. So I have to say, in fact, I despair of the amount of bullshit that's on the Green side, because I think it undermines our integrity, and I think it distracts people from taking direct action. You were talking earlier on about people getting involved in you know, Greenpeace and the Fair Just Work and the Just Transition sort of thing. They are the direct actions that people always got motivated by, and I think that by dealing with things at a super macro level, people are disempowered. You know, the conversation bullshit thrives as a structural feature of the whole conversation. I think there's no out, and really the way out of it is to deconstruct it and say, we can actually impact climate in your location on this issue and on that issue as well, and this one, and here there's a concatenation of things, and you need to be responsible for it. And that resonates with people. But
yeah, and I think now, like I said, now that I think the ethics, the politics, and the economics especially line up, I think that's going to be a much easier thing for the environmental movement to do.
Which is why the governments are changing the rules around protests,
right,
and being able to put in prison
right
for protests.
Right. So, Dave, to offer a criticism, Director, I would say that by focusing on bullshit on one side of the equation, you're actually enabling the whole thing inadvertently. I think, really, if you ought to really look at it from a structural point of view and not be partisan and say, this is a structural feature, and we're never going to get out of it unless
I mean, this is one of the things that we're going to look at in the Twitter storms around particular events. We're going to look at both sides, right? So that's why I showed the original tweet about that Abbott Point after Debbie, and then the reaction from the pro-Adani side. And we definitely want to trace the development of the discourse on both sides, absolutely. Because I'm just as curious about, you know, where the environmental discourse comes as I am about where the industrial discourse comes. And that's something that we can do on Twitter. Lots of people, and again, I just think it's the methodology now makes this a lot easier to do in terms of just sort of tracing influence. Whereas in the past, and people have done this, you know, I showed the funding of the denial industry, but people have done the same thing with the funding of the environmental industry and movement in the US. What are the foundations? Where does the money come from? Who's paying who? I mean, that's been done as well.
Who are the shitbots?
Huh?
Who are the shitbots?
The shitbots are new. But I do think, yes, we'll find shitbots everywhere.
Everywhere.
That's, yeah.
Can I just take this, because it's past the hour, I just wanted to thank David, because that was absolutely brilliant. Mm-hmm. And it was great to have such a fabulous audience to interesting new faces. So come back, please.
Yes.
Thanks.
Yes.